We're back to the Nile Haley Show here on the Total Celebrity segment. I'm excited to welcome to the program Adam Siara. He's the showrunner for a new show on NBC called The Resort. Adam, thanks for stopping by, man. How are you?
Great. Thank you for having me.
So tell me this showrunner thing, and then we'll get right into The Resort, because I saw the trailer, and it just looks action-packed. It could happen to anyone, but let's talk a little bit about what a showrunner does.
Yeah, I created the show, and I wrote the first episode and kind of like the whole like season outline. And then I went over to Sam Esmail, who is he created that show, Mr. Robot and Homecoming, and teamed up with him. And then we took it out to his home studio at UCP and sold it to Peacock. And then from that point on, I kind of just assembled a writer's room, wrote the season, hired, you know, everyone from directors to costume designers to production designers, all that. And then we gathered our crew and filmed out in Puerto Rico for about 4.5 months earlier this year. And then after that, I was kind of the showrunner to stays through post-production and all the editing process. And I finally have now just moved back into my own home office because we are officially done with the show as of a week ago. So,
okay. So tell me specifically, where in Puerto Rico you guys film?
We are filming kind of all over the island, and like kind of like our home base was in San Juan, and we took over this Ritz, and it became our kind of home base for about a month, where we turned this we made it into a 2007 hotel, and this is our production designer kind of remade the whole entire thing basically from the bones of the Ritz, and then we also flipped it over into an abandoned 2022 hotel that's kind of being overtaken by the jungle, kind of being reclaimed by the jungle. And that was just like one of our resorts. And as I've said in other interviews, it's a show called The Resort that by the end of the fourth episode, we actually destroy the resort and it becomes a jungle adventure and into the wild, basically.
All right. So let's talk about just the premise without giving anything away. Again, it premieres tonight on NBC. And then also Peacock, you can catch up on episodes in the Peacock network. I've been watching that since I've been traveling, and I'm into it. I said, I got to get the Peacock network now because it just gives you everything. You don't need any other type of streaming place, bottom line, because, you know, OTT networks are just where everything's going. But tell me specifically about The Resort, just the premise of the show.
Yeah. It's about a married couple who go down to a resort to celebrate their 10-year anniversary. And this marriage is kind of like at this lull. And then the first day that they're there, Emma, who is played by Kristen Milioti, she finds this old cell phone in the jungle, an old razor, and which belonged to a kid who went missing 15 years ago. And then this mystery kind of provides a keyhole into a much larger, bizarre, surreal mystery that she and her husband, Noah, who's played by Will Jackson Harper, solve. And as a result, like, you know, the question is, will this save their marriage or are they doomed? It takes them on this wild adventure that kind of transcends time. And then it kind of goes more in Indiana Jones realm for the second half of the series.
Okay. So, and then we have to find that out for sure each and every week. Or binge watch, as we all do, Andy, now is binge watch. So when you create series, you think about that in mind compared to the days of, you know, where it's weekly and people really could only catch up, maybe decide to go to the website, and now people just binge an entire show in 2 days. Do you think of that in the way?
Absolutely. And I think that, I'm so happy with the way that Peacock wanted to release this, because yes, it's going to be on NBC tonight, but if anyone who is intrigued by this first episode, they can go over to Peacock, where we'll have had the first 6 episodes, and starting tomorrow, have the first 7 episodes up. So you can binge it if you want, but people who have been watching it along the way, they're doing the weekly drop. And, you know, this is another big influence in the show is Lost too. And I was an obsessed college kid analyzing each episode of Lost every week. So I think that conversation between the weeks, so you can't just binge it all at once, that helps too. I think that's an exciting part of the viewing process, I think, for TV. So I think this show hopefully can kind of like satisfy both. If people would rather binge it,
I'm gonna binge it. It's already ready to binge. I mean, because I just, great, from the trailer alone, I say I'm binging this, because again, you talk about the resort, Puerto Rico, talking about the jungles, all the things in the show, and then also just the mystery. You like that kind of thing. And so you kind of, when you're looking at the show and putting this all together, you looked at Lost. So is that cool as a creator, like you are, to kind of say, man, I can now look at some of my favorite types of genres of stuff I've grown up watching and then put it and create it into my own thing? Is that cool or what?
Oh yeah. It's like a big giant sandbox for playing in. So it's kind of the best. Like, and this show is exactly that. It's a combination of like all the movies and books and stories that I grew up with and kind of thrown into this wild blender.
So where in the jungle did you film in Puerto Rico? In the jungle?
We're in Managas, which is this park there, and so we were kind of just all over this big mountain. And then for the last like 3 weeks of the filming, we actually went over the Dominican Republic, where there are some more jungles and some without giving away the ending, just some other parts of the land that we are able to film in, and then there's also some big stages there, and we have some big builds, some big set builds that are for our finale. So and the Dominican Republic had everything we needed there. So
what are you hoping that the viewers get out of it? What do you hope they get? Thrill or the thought process of what can happen to anybody? Because this can happen to anybody, truly, and maybe a little bit less of an extent, but you could end up going on vacation. It could be the vacation of hell. And so,
yeah, it's a you know, it's not. I would say it's not at all the show that you think it is when you watch the after the trailer, but like after the first episode, it's not just about a couple at a resort. It really becomes this. You know, this couple trying to recapture what went wrong in their marriage and in their lives that got them to this point in their life, and they're doing that by trying to solve this mystery of what happened to these two missing young adults. And we also are going into that story in the past. The two kids are played by Skylar Gisondo and Nina Bloomgarden, and Nina's dad is or Violet's dad is played by Nick Offerman, and it's that's a huge part of that the story as well. And then it becomes this like this attempt to recapture your past the entire time. So what I'm hoping for people to like kind of get from it is like in an attempt to recapture your past, it can both be sad and also just like silly and funny and thrilling. And then by the end, hopefully like on a very, very simple, my simple goal here is that I have two kids. After I put in the bed at night, I have about a half hour before I fall asleep. Sometimes I just want to like, you know, have a bowl of ice cream or a glass of wine and watch something entertaining for a half hour. And my goal is like have something that can be that, but also there's this other part of myself, like that part that would like watch Lost or read recaps of Mad Men every week to kind of like analyze it, where I, if you want to crack the codes of the show, if you want to lean in and read, go on Reddit and go down a little spiral like that, you can do that too, because this is a very intensely layered show that has answers to everything if you want to find the answers.
I love that. And that's exactly what you want. You want action, intrigue, a storyline, people that you want to follow, think about those specific things and all that. And, you know, kind of recapturing the past. You know, I again, another show I love on NBC is Young Rock, and I'm a former professional wrestler. So taking the journey of watching Dwayne go all the way to, you know, where it's gone in the first two seasons, what I love about the fact is that, oh my God, this reminds me of when I was in Memphis. I was in Memphis when The Rock was there, by the way. I was he wore my knee pads and one TV taping in Memphis. So recapturing your past, saying, okay, now I want to recapture that. Maybe I got to get back in the ring. So your hope is that, you know, in a couple's relationship, all these different things, look at ways that this speaks to you, but also you can escape reality for 30 for the time period. That's the ultimate goal. And you now, and you're creating, are looking at things in the next generation of where television's going. And that's series, binge watching. How can you keep you on the edge of their seat so they're ready to go and say, okay, I'm going to watch another episode. That's ultimately the goal. Great. Any other projects you have going on, people can check you out and stuff. Follow you and stuff. Is there places?
Before this, I wrote this movie called Palm Springs, and that came out like right in the dead center of the pandemic, and that was a So I have another thing I'm doing with, I was with Andy Samberg. I have another thing I'm doing with Andy Samberg. And then the other thing is like, we'll see if, I mean, this season one of the resort, it is a complete story. There's not really any loose threads. It gives a jumping off point perhaps for a character. And you know, so to watch, and then Peacock will like say, hey, well, let's do a second season. So that's, kind of the hope here. So,
and follow you, are you on social media, Instagram? What's best place to follow you?
Not really. I have a private Instagram that and I'm not on Twitter. I've decided to kind of like, I don't know, the world scares me, so
you're just a great creator.
I just post photos of my kids to my friends on Instagram.
Okay. So. But what I'm seeing is the next step for you is, you know, continue to great success in what you're doing. And I hope great success with the resort. And then it's on NBC tonight at what time? 8 p.m. Eastern?
I believe it's at 9 p.m. Yeah. Right after America's Got Talent. So yeah,
Right after. So it's a perfect, the jump from America's Got Talent to right to, wow, that's going to be huge for you. So I appreciate it, Andy. Thanks again. And hey, man, feel free to come jump on the show any other time. And I appreciate it. And best of luck with all your ventures. We're back to the Nile Haley Show here on the Total Celebrity segment. I'm excited to welcome the program my co-host, Kim Sorrell, author of Love Is. Kim, how are you? And I know you're excited about our guest.
Nile, I am very excited about our guest. I'm doing great. I hope that you are too. But I'm so excited because Eric, you're a very handsome man, first of all, I gotta say. But I know that priorities in your life have got to be Carrie, your beautiful wife. You've got two gorgeous daughters, Ella and Katie, and I'm sure that those are the key things for you. But you've also been on TV and movies and on the stage, and you've done so much, and you do so much, and you're famous for some of your roles, Nashville Without a Trace. I mean, you've done so many great things. And then this new movie, The Mulligan, that you also not just have to be an actor, but you've got to be a great golfer for the movie. So that kind of is a different twist. And then you're starring alongside Pat Boone, which is a legend in his own right. And so, Eric, welcome to the show.
Thank you. It's good to be here. Thanks for having me. Appreciate it. And you're too kind. The handsome comment, it's really these filters on Zoom. That's what it is.
Yeah, well, so The Mulligan, you know, you've been on Hallmark, one of my favorite channels. I got to say, I love those movies.
Mine too.
Yes. But The Mulligan is a whole different ballgame, and that is so good and so rich and so meaningful. And I know it's going to change people's lives by watching the movie. How did that come about for you?
Well, I was doing another movie in Toccoa, Georgia, a couple years prior to The Mulligan, and I was playing golf there, and this guy I was playing golf with, his dad is a producer, and he said, hey, my dad's working on developing this movie that's it's a Christian film, but it's based around golf, and it's a long way off, but would you ever be interested? And I said, absolutely, if it ever comes to pass, let me know. A couple years later, I got a phone call, and they said, hey, this is real now, are you still interested? I read the script, and I went, absolutely. Ironically, the book that the movie is based upon, called The Mulligan by Wally Armstrong and Ken Blanchard, I actually am friends with Wally Armstrong. I've known him for many, many years. And so when I found out it was his book, I was, I said, okay, this is clearly orchestrated by God that I'm supposed to be a part of this movie.
Now, so are you a golfer yourself, Eric?
Am I a good golfer?
Yeah, but you're
just a golfer. there's two different things. I love golf. As a matter of fact, I told a friend of mine yesterday, it's one of the great passions in my life. I started playing the game when I met my wife, because if I didn't, I probably would have been, kicked out of the family. So I love the game. It's had a lot of meaning in my life and helped me develop some wonderful friendships and the fellowship around the game. I'm so grateful for it. And it has a lot of life lessons in it, and that's you see that in this movie. It's golf. A lot of people debate what golf means, G-O-L-F, but I almost feel it's sort of like, it's a kind of a game called the game of life, because so many things that happen in golf represent things that happen to you in life.
Yeah, that's so true. I actually just sold my golf course. So I'm kind of passionate about the game myself. And you've got a great swing. So you obviously are a pretty good golfer. And so
yeah, well, I will tell you, Kim, that when you're filming a movie about golf, I have a pretty decent swing, but when you're on the golf course, there's a lot of pressure. And so the errors come and, you know, it's just going to happen because you're trying to hit a ball in a specific spot. When you're on camera and you're trying to remember your dialogue and you're hitting ball, you don't care where the ball goes. You just want to look good. So I remember one day we were out there and I hit a ball and I thought, oh boy, that was a great shot. And the next, everybody's kind of watching, where'd the ball go? And I'm holding my pose like, you know, oh, that was a great shot. And bam, it hits a guy's golf cart and everybody erupts in laughter because I shanked that ball full so far left. And it was to look good on camera, but it was not a good shot.
That's the funny thing about when you talk about things is you got to look good versus really perform when it comes to acting or anything. If you just, I'm sure you're in a sport like basketball, you got to shoot it and they got to make it look like you made it, right? You might not exactly. Even know it, but as long as you look good in the whole reaction and the whole thing versus really what's happening.
Absolutely. And, you know, I'll tell you, I debated when I first decided to take on this role, Paul McAllister, I debated whether I should have a more unorthodox swing, because when you go out and play public golf, you see all kinds of crazy swings. And then I thought, no, this is the kind of guy that he really strives hard in life to be kind of a perfectionist and good at what he does. So I assumed that he would at least have a pretty decent looking swing, because I think he's probably worked at it, because you could see how he is and how frustrated he gets when he's not playing well. So, but there was a moment where I thought, oh, it might be fun to have a really funky swing, but chose not to.
Probably a good choice, because yeah, that certainly is the kind of character he is, with his business, with his life, except his family, of course, but yes. In other areas, trying to be the best of the best, even though he broke a club and threw it into a pond or
well, wherever. Yeah, and that's what's a great line that Tom Lehman, the professional golfer in the movie, says to Paul. He says, you know, Paul, you're not good enough to get that mad. And I think anybody who plays the game of golf as an amateur gets to that point where they have to come to that realization. And I know in my own life, I did, you know, I really loved the game, but I took it too serious earlier in my life and it took some of the joy out of it. And I think sometimes that's just life in general. You take it so serious sometimes and you lose the joy of the journey of it. And even during the difficult times, you can be so focused on what's not going right that you forget to look at what is going right, or the joy of a relationship, even if, you know, recently we've lost a couple people in our family, and you can just totally focus on that and the grief of it. Or you can look and go, wow, what a great life and the memories we did have together. So I think that was a great lesson in the movie, is just, hey, don't take things so serious all the time. Don't sweat the small stuff.
You got to look at the seed and benefit for everything that's happened in your life, regardless of good, bad, the ugly, because it's a life lesson. Everything you do in life is a lesson to move mm-hmm. forward. You know, we relish always in only the good things that happen. When bad things happen to good people, which it happens to everyone, it's what seed of benefit are we going to gain from this? What is the reason why this happened to us? There is a underlying cause to this. And how do we move forward with that? And that's the huge thing, Eric. We don't. We miss out in life and we don't enjoy life because we're always looking to get upset and angry at our mistakes or
absolutely
or feel bad for ourselves instead of moving forward to see how can I serve someone else.
Yeah, it's if you're spot on. And if you embrace life that way, trusting, and this is the aspect of faith, is that, you know, at it, you can have faith, but if you're having faith only because you expect, oh, if I have faith, life's going to be perfect, you know. And I've a lot of times I've heard people say, oh, I've been following God my whole life and I have all these bad things happening in my life. Well, it's like, well, that's real life. And I've been guilty of it where I've felt like, oh, you know, if I'm paying my tithes and I'm going to church every Sunday and I'm being a good boy, nothing bad's going to happen. You know, God's going to like you know, his favor on me. Now, I will say he has poured his favor out on me. I'm so grateful for my life. But there's been a lot of hard times, too, and difficult things. And oftentimes, not because of anything I did. It's just that's life. And you can either let it really push you in a dark direction, or you can really strengthen your faith.
Yeah, well, and it's amazing the things that we go through, how we're then able to help other people through it. We can relate in a whole different way. When I was diagnosed with cancer a few years ago, people would say, oh, Kim, why you? Why you? You know, you do this, you help people here, you do that, you know, why you? And my response was always, well, why not me? Like, why would I be immune? You know, what would make me any different? You know, I love Jesus with my whole heart. That doesn't mean that you're not going to have some trials in your life and go through some hard times. But I'll tell you what, I can talk to people going through cancer, unlike people who have never been through it before. And I'm sure you probably have things that you've gone through in life that are the same.
Absolutely. You know, my brother, when he got cancer, he called it his blessed burden. And even though it was hard for him, even when it got to the worst, he still would take the time to, like, a guy would come over to clean the carpet, and, you know, my brother would be pretty close to the end of his life, and he'd be like, hey, can I pray for you? What's going on? And the guy would go, oh yeah, I've had this thing going on in my life. And suddenly my brother's taking the attention off his cancer and trying to pour into somebody else. And, you know, every day wasn't like that. There were tough days where he was, you know, shaking his fist at God and why is it me? But then his faith, his strength and his faith in God got his perspective back on track. And he was able to take that and really live into that term that he gave his cancer, called a blessed burden.
And this movie, The Mulligan, really shows faith in so many ways without giving it away, right, Eric? Explain your character a little bit more to people and understand who's around you and how this is going to be a really great inspirational movie for people.
Well, I think a lot of people can relate to Paul's journey in the movie. You know, I find that at his core, Paul's a good guy, you know, and he means well. He wants to be successful. He, you know, this is kind of the path in life. You know, we're all kind of taught, go to college, do this, you know, work really hard, nose to the grindstone kind of thing. But also we are a product of our upbringing and different things that have happened to us in our life. And Paul, you know, had a pretty rough childhood in the sense that he didn't have a great father figure. And so that kind of fueled him to sort of in his life prove to dad that he was better than who his dad was. And that drove him to be uber successful. But he becomes very successful in the world's terms. But unfortunately, the cost of that is that he's losing his family. His marriage is falling apart. He's estranged from his son. And those are the important things. So he's got this massive wallet and he's, you know, bank account, but he's losing the most important things in his life. And through the game of golf and meeting this guy, old pro played by Pat Boone, and he played this role brilliantly. Through the lessons of golf, the life lessons I was talking about earlier, the old pro is able to help Paul put things in different perspective and help him see his life in a different way and see what's really important, and that he can still be successful. He can still have a successful business, but find a restructuring of balance in his life. And what I love about the message is that while you're still on earth, you have that second chance. And God gives us more than just one second chance. I mean, we get lots of chances and they're there. We just have to be willing to take them. Admit that we've messed up sometimes and go, man, I really have messed this up, but I want another chance. And I love those. I've always been drawn to redemption stories. That's what I love about, you know, It's a Wonderful Life. And you can go on and on. The list of, you know, redemption stories are awesome. And that's the grace of God. And so I love that about this movie, that this guy, and look, he has a choice. He has a choice whether he's going to accept it or and make that shift, or he's just going to go, eh, that's a bunch of hooey. I'm going to keep just doing what I'm doing and lose my family and my son. And Paul's a prideful character. No question. He's got a lot of pride. And I think that's his weakness, is his pride. And you know, he eats some humble pie in the movie. And I think that also helps, you know, realign him a bit.
Yeah. Well, even in taking a mulligan, right. And the thought of taking a mulligan, he was so against it. And then when he really understood it, it was humbling.
The mulligan, if you play golf, I love the game of golf. I don't like mulligans when I'm playing serious golf because they're not part of the rules. Mm-hmm. But in a friendly game and you're playing with your friends and someone goes, take a mulligan, it means so much. And in getting that, you know, and we usually, most golfers will give each other a mulligan on the first tee. So you go and if you hit a terrible first shot, then you go, okay, I'll take mulligans. But I will tell you, more times than not, if I've hit a bad first drive and I get a mulligan, the second one's usually pretty good. And it's because you kind of relax. And in life, sometimes it's important to get that mulligan, to get that second chance. And there's no rule in life that says you can't get a mulligan.
And I think in a lot of ways, a mistake, a challenge, a thing where, you know, it didn't work out as we did, that's the mulligan to move forward and move forward the next day and the next opportunity or the next situation. You know, oh man, I lost a client. Oh man, I lost this job. Oh, I lost a relationship. Well, it's time to move forward for the next thing. You can't just wallow in your sorrow. You got to move forward, as I talked about, the seed of benefit and everything. And what is your goal, Eric? It seems like you chose this movie in a lot of ways, or chose you in so many ways. What is your goal? What do you want to see the movie? What do you want the viewers to get out of seeing this film? What do you hope?
Well, first of all, I hope it draws people closer to a relationship with Christ, with Jesus. You know, that's the most important thing, that they, because without him, you know, life really doesn't matter. It doesn't mean it starts with him. It starts with a relationship with God. So I hope that the movie inspires someone to say, man, I really can't just do this life on my own, you know, by my own strength, because nobody really can. Even the most successful of the world standards, they may think, oh yeah, I got it all together, but life has a way of humbling us all. So that would be my first goal, I think, is just that I would hope that this movie would inspire somebody to have a relate to kind of, you know, maybe they're like, God, really? At least just kind of explore it and just say, hey, God, if you're real, help me. I'd love to know you better. So that's important. But also, I want people to be entertained. I want people to enjoy the performances, enjoy the stories. And I was just thinking about this on the way here, on the way to the interview to talk with you guys this morning. I was thinking about the story about the 99, where it talks about the shepherd leaving. If he has 100 sheep and he leaves the 99 to go find the one lost sheep, right? I feel like if this movie inspires one person to try and heal a relationship, a broken relationship, whether it's with a child or a spouse or a friend, or to turn a path in life where maybe they made some poor choices, whatever it is, my hope is that even if it's one person in a movie theater that sees this and their life is affected by it in a good way, I feel mission accomplished. And at the end of the day, if people just go away entertained and they feel great and they're like, you know, I'm feeling pretty good in my life and I like where I am in my life, I feel strong in my relationship with God and all that, they're just going to see a great movie, good, wonderful performances. You know, like I said, everybody did an awesome job. Michael did a fantastic job as a director, and it's beautifully shot. You know, we shot this amazing golf course, the Currie Golf Club in Toccoa, Georgia. And also, like I told you, I love golf. I'm passionate about it. So if it inspires some people to go out and give it a go, I would love that, because I love growing the game. I love to know when people come to get excited about the game of golf and embrace the tradition, the history of it. So, you know, if someone comes away from the movie and goes, I think I'm gonna go give that game a try, it looks fun, or, you know, go for it, that's cool too.
Yeah, I love that. I love all of it, the whole mission. And you know, some of it comes down to people being willing to change or knowing that they can, knowing that they're allowed to change their opinion on something or better their life in whatever way, or even take up the game of golf. The movie, I feel like it gives people permission to do that. Like, you don't have to stay where you're at. You can move on. You can strive for something better, something greater, a better life for yourself, for those around you. And that movie, to me, does that.
Yeah. I'd say that I think my primary goal with this movie, my hope for this movie, is that it would inspire people to seek if they don't have it already, a personal relationship with God through Christ, that they can have that relationship. And because really, in my opinion, life really isn't full without that relationship with God. And so I think that is number one. And then number two is I just hope that people are entertained. There's great performances in it. The movie's beautifully shot. I hope that there's a chance that if people are struggling in maybe their relationships with their family or friends, or their own personal life, if they're just, they don't feel worthy, that it will inspire them to know that there is second chances and more than that in life. They just have to reach out and be willing to accept those second chances. That's the mercy of God. That's the grace of God. And that comes through friends and families, acquaintances, a colleague at work, a stranger sometimes. And I also, you know, I also hope that maybe if people are looking at this movie going, well, that golf, I've been thinking about playing golf or giving it a whirl, it maybe it would just inspire them to go out and give it a try or get their kids into it. It's a great thing for parents to do, you know, a father to do with his daughter or his son and go out and play golf. Or, you know, my wife and I are now empty nesters. My wife and I go play golf together. It's a great way to fellowship together. It's a fun sport. It's healthy. You're out there in the fresh air and it's a challenging sport. It's really hard, but it's so rewarding when you start to kind of get the hang of it. And I would hope that the movie would inspire people in that way as well. But most importantly, you know, just a relationship with God and also just knowing in their life that there are second chances. And not to give up.
That's very important.
Yeah, and I will tell you, you know, there was a woman who had reached out to me. The movie had premiered in the movie theaters in my hometown, and the next day I received a DM message from a lady that lives in a town right near mine, and she said, "I just wanted you to know that my husband's not a golfer, and he didn't really want to see a golf movie." And she said, "No, let's go see it." And they went to see it, and she said after the movie, he was so moved by the story that he broke down and started crying. And he revealed to her a bunch of things that he had been holding on to for years, like decades, that he never shared with her about some unresolved grief in his life and guilt in his life. And that moment changed their relationship and took their relationship to a whole nother level. And there was healing. And just so my feeling was, even if that one person had an effect on just that one person, the movie was successful. And so I hope that that movie inspires people to, you know, to reflect on their lives and seek him and grow.
Wow. And this movie reminds you of, Kim, what you learned in Love Is, going through this challenge of going and trying to figure out what love is for that journey, right, Kim, in writing the book?
Yeah. Well, Eric, I mentioned that I had cancer, and 4 months later, my husband was diagnosed with pancreatic cancer and passed away 6 weeks later. Yes, and I, when I was through my medical stuff, found myself on the ground in Haiti within 2 weeks after the earthquake that killed 200,000 people. So I went there and worked, like the work that you do in South Africa, which thank you so much for helping kids and helping people there. And, but I questioned love. And so I dedicated a full year to learning the true meaning of love. And what I found out just kind of blew my mind. I used the love chapter as sort of a roadmap. And I learned so much about love. In fact, I'd love to share my book with you. I'd love to send you a copy.
Awesome.
I think you might enjoy it.
Absolutely. And first of all, I'm sorry, you know, to hear about the loss of your husband. You know, I just went through that with both my mother-in-law and my brother, and within a year of each other. Just so, my brother died in December, and so yeah, I know that journey, and I know how challenging it is, but also, you know, praise God that I'm sitting here talking to you, and you got that opportunity to be in Haiti, and I know some other folks that were down there right after that, and how devastating that was. But know that, you know, people like yourself were there on the ground helping. And then now you're sharing it through your book, your experience, and encouraging other people, I think is just fantastic.
Well, thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you for everything you do. And it's pretty amazing.
Like I said earlier in the interview, I feel incredibly blessed in my life to have the career that I've had. When I first started, I didn't know what was going to transpire. I thought, okay, I'll give it a go, and I'm going to try my hardest. And I really did feel God was calling me into this industry. I mean, I prayed about it and said, okay, if this is what you want me to do, Lord, just make it clear to me. And he made it very clear that this is what I was supposed to do. And I think I mentioned to you, it opened doors for me, not only as a professional actor, but also because I've been so fortunate to do this, it's opened the world to me and my family and my friends. And I'm so grateful for the career that I've had and the blessings that have come with it, not only just being able to take care of my family, but it really has opened the world to me and my family. And, you know, back in 2008, I was doing a series for CBS, and they flew me to South Africa to do some promotion. And I did some PSAs for CBS Cares. And one of those PSAs was for an organization called CC Africa that became the Africa Foundation. And my wife and I got involved. And over the last, I don't know, what is it, since 2008, it's been quite a while, we've been involved in helping raise money to build schools and orphans and vulnerable children centers in certain communities in South Africa. And we just went back with our daughters, just got back 3 days ago. We were down there for 3 weeks and spent time in the community, and we got to hand over the latest preschool and this big celebration, and it was just awesome. And and I'm grateful, and I was telling Kim that I hope that this movie plays all over the world and it makes it into different languages and people, you know, because it's not, while the movie revolves around golf, it's a movie about life and how we deal with life from a faith perspective. And so I think that message will resonate with people all over the world, not just here in North America.
When I spoke to Tanya, that was when the movie first came out in the theaters. Now, this is the big announcement, Eric. It's available now everywhere else, right?
Yeah, it's available across streaming platforms. It's out on DVD. I love it because a lot of people that didn't get a chance to see it when it was in its theatrical release, because it was a limited release. Now people are, I'm getting emails and texts, people, and, you know, Facebook messages. Hey, we saw your movie. We loved it. And I got to watch it with my kids or with my, you know, my parents or whoever. And that's the other thing I love about this movie. It has some pretty intense subject matter as far as, you know, some tragedy in life that it happened to a couple of the characters. But it's a movie you can watch with your whole family. You know, you're not covering your kids' eyes when you watch this movie. There's not, it's just a beautiful story that everybody can relate with.
Yeah, that's amazing. It is a great story, and it's a great message, and one that should be out there, and one that I'm sure will touch a lot of hearts.
Yeah, yeah.
Right. Best
that's my hope.
Eric, to find information on you, the organization that you're helping bring awareness, anything you want to give people to check out, and where they can check out the movie. It's available on all the different streaming platforms right now.
Yeah. So I would say if you want to see the movie, I would, you know, Google it and just type in how can I see what platforms, and it'll be, you can see it on Prime and all those other streaming, you know, sites. You can go to, I believe you can go to Walmart and get the DVD. It's on sale there now. As far as different organizations. I would, you know, if anybody has any interest in Africa Foundation, it's africafoundation.org or africafoundationusa.org. You'll be able to find that as well and just kind of see what the organization, the work that they're doing in the community. What's nice about it, and I won't go on too far because we're really here to talk about the movie, but the organization works with the communities and helps meet the needs that the community is trying, the needs they have, not going in and saying, oh, we're going to do this. They go into the community and they say, what do you need? And they go, well, because a lot of times people think, oh, we just build wells, so we're going to go build a well. But the community might say, we already have a well. What we really need is a clinic where people can come and get, you know, their medicine or whatever they need or food. They work in relation with the community and really seek what they need instead of forcing an agenda.
Yeah, I love that. But it makes such a difference, right? When you work alongside people instead of in front of them, and you just work alongside, and they understand the culture, they understand the real needs, they understand the language, they understand what's going on way better than we do, who just happen to be stopping by. So that's the way to do it.
Absolutely, absolutely. Yeah, it's working. I like what you said, working alongside instead of in front. Yeah.
All right. Well, fantastic, Eric. We appreciate it. Kim Sorrell, you can go to loveis.what, Kim, again?
Loveis.info.
.info. I'll remember that.
Yes. Not you want to know what real love is, loveis.info.
Or Kim Sorrell, the only Googling Kim Sorrell. There's only one Kim Sorrell with two R's and two L's. So it's really simple. And people check it out. And I'm sure you're being Googleable more and more, Kim, every day with meeting amazing people like Eric. Eric, you're doing such great work, mission and everything. Everyone needs to check out the mulligan and the story, definitely, and such great characters. And get out and golf. Enjoy life. We're back to the Nile Haley Show here on the Total Celebrity segment. I'm excited to welcome the program my co-host, author of Love Is, Kim Sorrell. Kim, what's going on? How are you? And I know you're excited about our guests.
I am really excited about our guest. I'm doing great. Thanks, Nile. Justin Johnson Cortez. Oh, my word. You have done, I don't know how many movies now. You probably know the number. But
I don't.
And you have a great role in the much anticipated prequel to Walker Independence. And that has to be a pretty cool role to play. How did that happen for you?
Yeah, well, first of all, it is a very cool role to play, and it's a great role to play in. And the cast and the crew and production, everyone's incredible. But it came my way, like most things do, you know, through an audition, and I got the sides for it. And to be honest, and this would probably come up naturally, but or in another way, but I was a little hesitant at first because it's a period piece, and being Native American, I just didn't want that to be the same old story, you know, the same old Indian and that they've shown in the past with Westerns. And I grew up watching lots of Westerns, and I tell people this all the time. I wanted to be the cowboy because I had all the fun, and you know, it was always kind of about them. And so I was a little hesitant. I wanted to make sure that maybe we're going to do something different here, and that this character wasn't just going to just kind of be expendable in a way. And but after meeting the producers and director, they really eased my mind about that, and I was on board 100%.
So let's talk about this, Justin. You know, think about Yellowstone. Do you think Yellowstone's depicting Native Americans in the right way?
You know what? I think Taylor Sheridan is doing a really good job. He's always been great about putting natives in his stories, and it's not necessarily that he's not depicting them in the right way. And I would love to work with him in the future. But I think with me in the past watching those other, you know, growing up watching Westerns, it's like the Indians were kind of just on the side a bit. And what I love about Taylor is he's kind of putting them in the mix. You know, he's getting them out there, and these characters have arcs, and they're interesting, and they play vital roles in the story. And so that's kind of what I wanted to do. I wanted to play a vital role in the story. So I think he's doing a great job, and people love his shows, and, you know, he can't do any wrong over there. I have a friend who's on a show, so I think they're about to be on one of his shows, so I don't even know if I'm allowed to say that yet, actually. He's doing great stuff, and you know, any opportunity for diversity to be on the screen and to kind of show different culture is always great, man. So I'm pumped for it. And I think it's great that people are kind of coming back towards Westerns. And I feel like Taylor is kind of, he's giving a certain demographic, a certain generation these shows. And I'm excited about our show because I feel like we might be able to reach a younger audience a bit, you know, the younger adult audience.
CW gives it the CW.
And we have great fans of the CW. CW is amazing. And not to say it's only young people, because we got people all across the board. But I am excited to see maybe the younger generation getting a glimpse into the Westerns with us, you know.
Think about another depicting does well, and I'll pass it back on to Kim, is Outer Range. I don't know if you got the chance to see Outer Range. It's really well done. I don't know if there's going to be a second season or not that was on Amazon.
Oh, I hope so.
I really liked it. It was a good show, and it kept me going, and I didn't see the Rotten Tomatoes the level I thought it should have been, but you never know. The fans always have the next set. All right, Kim.
Yeah. Back to you. Great show.
Yeah. So here you get to really tap into your heritage, but you've played other roles where that hasn't been the case. So mm-hmm. What's the difference for you? Like, how does that feel?
Oh, I love playing. Any opportunity to act is great. You know, anytime you get to do what your dream is, it's incredible. So, I think it's wonderful to be able to play in a culture that is, that means something to you. I think that's a great opportunity. And actually for this, I play Apache, which I'm not Apache, I'm Yaqui, but I get to learn Apache for the show. So I'm kind of getting a glimpse into a culture that isn't my own. And I feel very fortunate that they welcomed me into their world a bit. And they gave me that permission to portray this character. I have great people that are doing translations, and that family is incredible. And we wouldn't be able to do the show without them. And so the fact that they've kind of given me that blessing to speak their language and to portray their heritage is really, really means a lot to me. So I have a big respect, and I feel like a big responsibility to be able to do that. And I want to do it well. And, you know, ultimately I would love to just be able to play any role without having to be, you know, fill any box, check any mark, you know, as a diversity cast. You know, I want to be able to play any role that you see, and maybe not, it doesn't matter. No one has to justify why I'm that character, I guess, if that makes sense, you know? But there's a big responsibility that I feel personally for playing Native characters. And I want to make sure that, you know, I'm going to do as best I can to do it right. And the producers and the team behind Walker Independence, they're really doing their best to make sure we're doing it right as well.
So. Yeah, and it's interesting when you talk about that process, the responsibility. Now you talk about it a little bit, but what other actors do you look up to that have playing the Native Americans that you look up to as an actor?
Yeah, well, you know, and like I said, the ones that I grew up with, I feel like, you know, there's always been great actors in the past that have done it, but I feel like just coming today, so there's a great show called Rutherford Falls, and Michael Gray Eyes is on that show. He's a great actor, and I feel like that show in particular, it's a Native story, you know, and it stars, I forget his name, he's a comedian, he's a funny guy, he's a great actor. He's not Native, but it stars him, but it's just such a, the culture, if you watch it, you know, there's so much Native culture in there. And I really admire that about that show. And, you know, like I said, Michael Gray Eyes is a great actor, and I love watching his work, whether it's on that or anything else he's done. I forget the name of it. Derek C. in France did a miniseries with Mark Ruffalo, and Michael was in that show. And he just does great work all around, you know. So to be able to just see working actors that are Native, I'm always just pumped and excited for it, you know. Even when they're my competition, even when I know that, like, you know, Martin Sensmeyer is going out there and he's getting all these great roles, but it's awesome. It's just a victory for everyone, you know?
Exactly.
Yeah, that's got to be a good feeling for sure. But you've got this look, this face that you could be anybody and play any role. You do such a great job. But I'm curious, like, because you're Native American and there's been so much bad that the country has done, so many things that are not going well, so many things that could change. How do you see it? Like, what would you like to see changed?
That's a heavy question. It's a big question. You know, there's a lot of history. There's a lot of history, and you know, all we can do is move forward and try our best, you know, and I like to see when people are doing that. And I like that it seems like a lot more people are taking responsibility for maybe the past and willing to see change. And that movement started with the Native community, and it's moving forward. And you know, it's just like giving ourselves a voice and allowing us to be heard. And social media did a good job of, you know, I'm not a huge social media fan. I'm just bad at it, but I've seen some of the great things it could do when it comes to getting positive messages out there. So it's just like, you know, it starts here with the stories being told, you know, allowing people to tell their stories that maybe weren't told before. So these younger kids could understand that they have a place and they have a voice and they're seen, and it gives them confidence going forward. And then they could start to change there. You know, it starts in the community and it really goes out, but we need to give people the confidence and the courage and kind of like, and make them know that they're seen. A big movement right now, I don't know if you've heard of MMIW. It's about missing and murdered Indigenous women and Indigenous people all around. But that's it's like an epidemic, you know. These women are 10 times more likely to be violently assaulted than non-Native women are. I actually just finished shooting a film that revolves around that issue. So that's something, a movement that is really, yeah, it's called Gift of Fear. So that will be out hopefully next year. And yeah, it's just, you know, movements like that are trying to make people more aware of what's going on and maybe things that people didn't know was happening, and just get allies, you know?
And I think that's the thing, you say you're not very good on social media, or however you termed it. The bottom line is that you're taking that responsibility to speak out during the interviews and all that stuff. And that you probably are, you don't have the time, the shoots, all those different things. When you have some downtime, you just grab it, jump on certain things and provide that. And I'm very impressed by how you're representing your Native Americans, and they have to be very proud. And there should be more actors in this industry. It's missing, truly. And I think that you're going to help step that up through these opportunities, through again the role. So I'm going to pass it back to Kimo, talk about the show. And I'm ultimately a fan of the first one, Walker Texas Ranger, so I have no idea the nuances between all those, so I'll have a question probably. Mm-hmm.
Go ahead, Kimo. All right,
yeah, so the show is coming when is it released?
October 6th. Yeah, so it'll be out October 6th, and I hope I got that right. I think that's right. you know, dates get jumbled in your mind, but it'll be out this fall. So this fall, you can check it out, Walker Independence on the CW, and we'll be airing right after the series premiere, season three premiere of Walker. So it'll be our series premiere, their season three premiere, and yeah, so you can check out both. And I know you're a fan of the previous one, you said, and that's a great show. Great people behind that show, great cast. Yeah, and Walker, you know, Walker Independence, we're just excited to be a part of the family, you know, and tell this story, this origin story of the Walkers. And, you know, we have a great set of, you know, we have a great cast. We have a great set of characters to show people. And it's going to be a lot of fun, man. Like this morning, we're out there riding horses. We're training. So we start shooting very soon here. So we're out riding horses. It's just, you know, doing a period piece could be a lot of fun. And we're definitely enjoying it.
So take me back now. Okay, so let's go to the history. I'm sure you had to learn about the Walker on the CW as well once you got the role, unless you already were watching. Go to Walker Texas Ranger. They had a remake of Walker Texas Ranger with Walker 3 years ago. And it's the third season for that. Explain that, and what's the difference between Walker and Walker Independence? Because we have so many things to binge now and watch things. So explain, yeah.
Well, the beauty of it being a prequel is we're connected to them, but we're kind of free to kind of go where we go, you know? And I wish I could actually have more answers for you, because I don't know yet. I don't know it all. I know that if you watch the trailer, you could see this very, very beautiful, very strong woman. And she says, "I'm Abby Walker." And that's kind of the taste that people are going to get for now. And as we dig in, then we'll figure out, all right, how does she connect to the Walker family? But ultimately, this is, you know, this is a matriarch. This is the beginning of the Walker legacy. So that, that's kind of the connection.
So and Walker, just to try to get the answer to that question, Walker Texas Ranger is exactly the same Walker, just in a different actors, a remake of Walker Texas Ranger's Walker. Is that correct?
Yeah. So now we're going in the
way back. And that's gotta be cool. I mean, and bringing back Westerns, they were really smart, the CW. And Kim, I'm gonna explain that to you as well, is that Westerns has such a huge following. Westerns, there is such a cult for Westerns that are lacking. And now, as you said, bringing the diversity and bringing it in the right way compared to Westerns back in the 50s and 40s and 60s to where we are today, that's fantastic for where it's going. But ultimately, there are Western fans everywhere, and they got to be excited about this. And now bringing a younger generation to Westerns. I was bringing up something in an interview I was doing with another celebrity that's big into metal. And I said, you know, thanks to Stranger Things, now heavy metal's coming back. So you find these different trends of young people finding different things. And am I right? Was one of the characters in this new season of Stranger Things is a Native American, right? Am I correct?
Yeah. I believe so. I forget his name. I think he's the pizza guy who grabs the pizza delivery guy.
Man, I'm just a huge Stranger Things fan. I gotta find enough time to binge everything. You know what I mean?
Where's the time, man? Well, you better make time for Walker Independence. You gotta check it out.
Yeah, I am going to make time for that for sure. And we're gonna get the last thing. But go ahead, back to you, Kim, with any questions you have for Justin.
Yeah. I think it's very exciting. And I know so many people that are so into Westerns and watch the old ones. So to see the new ones will be so much better, just so much better. So so we're hopefully you're gonna do season after season of this, right?
Yeah, hopefully.
So how many years before does it take place?
So this takes place back in like the 1870s. So we're going over 100 years back. You know, we're going way back. And you know, kind of to talk about what you said, how, you know, you get this younger generation. It's because, you know, the people making the show, they grew up watching Westerns. It's a part of them. And you know, you want to make what you love. And so it's really great because that's what happens. You fall in love with something, you make it, and you pass it down. You pass it down to your next generation. And the people, you know, the cowboy, the Western culture, it's huge. And so it's great to have people that are excited to see this show. And I'm excited for them to see what Callion brings, you know. So I play Callion, he's Apache, and he's an Apache scout on the show. And he's kind of outside of Independence, and he's curious about it. He has a connection into town through the deputy, Augustus. But he's hesitant, you know, because he's kind of torn between two worlds. And so I'm excited for people to see Callion and meet him and see where this character goes, and especially for a lot of fun. Like I said, we're gonna have a lot of fun, man. There's gonna be some action, there's gonna be drama, there's gonna be, you know, there's gonna be a little bit for everybody. I feel like, you know, you could have grandpa watching the show, but you could also have, you know, your teenage daughter watching the show. It's gonna be for everybody.
For sure. So again, best place we can connect with you, social media and stuff, where can we go? Best place.
Instagram. It's the only one I got, unfortunately. I'm not on Twitter or anything else, but Instagram, it's JustinJ_Cortez, I believe. You just type in Justin Johnson Cortez, it should pop up. I try to stay on it, try to let people know what's going on and post some pictures and stuff when we're having some fun. But I'm gonna try to keep up with it. But I got some great cast members who are, you know, follow Walker Independent on the CW. And they're going to be putting stuff out there, but great cast members here and such a great family we got here, and they'll all be posting fun stuff. So I'll be popping up on all theirs as well.
You'll be jumping on it more. Trust me. It'll probably happen for sure. And all that stuff. And hey, you're a busy actor, and that's the good thing, is to stay busy. And Kim, where can we connect with you? Best place?
Yeah. Kim Sorrell. I'm literally the only Kim Sorrell in the world, spelled my way, Sorrelle, but kimsorrell.com. My latest book, Love is available everywhere, Amazon and everywhere else. Justin, I'd love to send you a copy.
And, absolutely. Please do.
Yeah. Well, great. Well, I'll get your address and send it over to you.
Always good to get you out there in different places. And it was great to talk with you, Justin, and appreciate it.